Good. Second tutorial. Again, thanks for having me here, myself and David. Yeah, and again, we decided to make David's class and the tutorials sort of complementary approach. And so I'm going to talk about more the practical aspect of some of the phase conscious methods. I've sort of put as a subtitle a quick survey, which is maybe a bit too generous. I'm probably going to go a sort of personal cross section again on phase conscious thinking methods. And what I would like to stress is probably mostly the similarities between methods and how similar ideas sort of pops out in different approaches. And that there's a theory, or at least a reason underneath it. David mentioned and explained his method on propagation-based, so I won't discuss much propagation-based, but just a bit of phase gradient method, so that means gradients or ABI. And in the spirit of having a bit of discussing the similarities, I put there ABI, analysis-based imaging and gradient interferometer are closer than you think. Then I decide to add one more, and there's going to be scanning transmission, X-ray microscopy, and speckle scanning are closer than you think. So, sorry, it's not there, but I will discuss it quickly. Okay, so again, personal cross-section of phase conscious imaging method, and having worked with David for many years, it can't be other than the practical intensity equation. He mentioned David derived that equation and approximated in the case of a single material. In that case, you can solve it exactly. Now, if we don't do that, then we just expand this product here. So you've got product of intensity and transverse gradient of the phase. So you can expand it, and you've got two bits and. So you've got a dot product between intensity gradient and phase gradient, and then you've got the intensity times the phase Laplacian. Okay. So if we forget about this term here, so we just focus on that. Well, this is the conventional propagation-based phase conscious imaging. So you've got an image that is proportional to the intensity times some high frequency. Phase Laplacian there, so edges are enhanced and everything looks sort of sharper and crisper. On the other hand, if you focus on the first term there, you've got a phase gradient. So the phase gradient is what is measured in a whole lot of other techniques, analysis based gradients, Dixon, and so on. But again, staying at the equation, within the limit of validity of the transport of intensity equation, we came up with two observations. So we can see two things. The first is obviously, look at that. So all these terms here are multiplied by a factor z in there. Z is the propagation distance. So that means that in general, in most cases, all phase conscious imaging techniques needs propagation. So there is one technique that we call propagation-based. In fact, they are all propagation-based to some extent. But okay, obviously the names stick. So as propagation-based, we always call the one that is sensitive to Laplacian. But all of them are sensitive to. All of them require propagation. The second point is that in general you've got always both contributions. You've got phase gradient and phase Laplacian. In most cases, you can neglect one of the two, and so just focus on the other. But in general, you've got it. So take that into account. Okay, so now, if we focus only on the phase gradient methods, okay, I decide to divide them in two big broad categories that I call single image and multiple image. Okay? So single image is something like speckle tracking, for instance, in which we got a wave field up there, illuminating the object. So we measure the wave field with or without the object. We see what effect has the object on this wave field. And from that, we can work out the attenuation, we can properly work out the phase gradients in vertical and horizontal and other quantities. Then we got methods that requires multiple images. So in this case, there is some scanning involved. Either the sample, the optics, something happened. In this case, you will have, you can receive similar images. Typically, single image is faster. So if one needs time resolved or low dose, single image is faster. Multiple image is more accurate, more sensitive, better resolution, and so on. In general, all those techniques require some modulation of the wave field. So if I go back one step, actually two steps, and here, if we want to measure a phase gradient, we need some intensity gradient in the field. So if this is zero, you don't get any phase gradient. So if there is a slowly modulating wave field, as we have in a phase-based propagation, then pretty much this term is zero here, and we just measure the Laplace. If we introduce some intensity gradient, grids, speckles, centripetals, and so on, then immediately we've got phase gradient sensitivity. So single image methods, like for instance speckle tracking, will work out the position of the speckles with or without the sample. Have the speckle moved, that is proportional to the phase gradient in horizontal and vertical direction. So in this case, this intensity gradient, or the measurement itself, lives in the two-dimensional space of the detection. Okay? Scanning techniques, on the other hand, have some changes over across. So we had a two-dimensional image, but we have a third dimension. So sort of, loosely speaking, a sort of phase space. So you need some, for instance, an angular coordinate there, crystal scanning or gradient scanning, and so on. And the phase gradient is worked out adding this additional information. So that is why generally, scanning methods are more sensitive than a single image method. Okay. Now, I don't discuss at all phase retrieval, or especially various techniques, you know this better than I do. I want to only discuss two analogies. One is between analysis-based and gradient interferometry. I divided the various phase retrieval methods in, again, two categories. One is I call geometric and one I call convolution. And before I explain what I mean, I want to say that the first technique that was used with the grading was called fringe scanning or phase stepping method. And that made the approximation that the transfer function, the transmission function of the grading was periodic. Now let's forget about the periodicity at the moment. So I won't discuss phase stepping in here. If we forget about that, we'll have two transmission functions, a crystal rocking curve, for instance, and a transmission function from double grading or one grading and so on. So in both cases, what the sample does, it's changing the black curve into the red curve, so changing attenuating the beam, refracting the beam, and eventually a small angle scaling, so a small refraction that happens isotropically or more or less in space, which will broaden or smear a little bit the contrast of the transmission function. So the first algorithm that historically was derived by Chapman diffraction enhanced imaging was using a geometric approach. By geometric, I mean we tend to expand this transmission function, and we approximate it somewhere that is aligned. So for instance, the flanks of the rocking curve, or expanding the sine function around zero. These are lines. Okay, so we assume that these are lines, and in this case we can have two images and make the phase retrieval. To the approximation, to the extension which this approximation is good, you need just two images. you can make a better approximation, and instead of saying that this is a line, we say that locally it's a parabola, so we can expand to the second order, so you get three images. But you can do for both. And then later on, a more clever approach is developed. So in this case, you, instead of any approximation, you can actually deconvolve the sample action on the transition function. And so this is what I call convolution approach, or maybe better should be called deconvolution approach, in which the effect of the sample is deconvolved from the transition function. So if you forget about the periodicity, in fact, those are grids look the same, more or less. So a few variations across. But that would explain why similar things eventually were developed independently by the different communities. Typically, on those techniques, you will measure three or more parametric images. The one that is on the top is generally called attenuation contrast. The one in the middle is called refraction or differential phase contrast. And then the one at the bottom is called scattering or dark field contrast. But as I said before, all those techniques require propagation. So in fact, what we call attenuation image is always, in most cases, at least for synchrotron, is always a propagation phase contrast image. So you always have Laplacian contrast in what we call attenuation image from for instance, a gradient interferometer. And so this information can actually be used to do phase retrieval. So historically, phase retrieval for propagation base was done in many ways. But propagation base phase retrieval for gradient base methods was done only looking at the phase, the differential phase. In fact, you got both. And so I point out that this has been done, and this is the paper that David was mentioning earlier by Konstantin Pavlov in 2005, which he worked out a unification within the transport of intensity equation between phase retrieval done in using Laplacian base and refraction base images. Okay, so the last part of my talk is about similarities between scanning transmission X-ray microscopy and speckle scanning. This is something actually we've been discussing with David for long, because it's relevant for ghost imaging. I will discuss ghost imaging tomorrow. But I think it can be extended to phase contrast imaging. And so that's a scanning transmission sketch. So you've got the scanning sample across the beam. Now, if you actually measure the beam, so you have a position sensitive detector there, you can measure the same thing. So the beam will be deflected, will be broadened, and be attenuated by the sample. And if you scan the sample, or as you scan the sample across, you will be damaged. So again, you'll end up with, for instance, you get the first moment. If you interpret that the beam profile as a distribution, you can calculate the first moment, which is the average, and so that's going to be proportional to the attenuation. But then you can get, a higher order moment, so refraction, scattering, some deviation, if you want, of the distribution, and you can work out all possible moments of this distribution. In fact, you can. Why you want to stop only at the second order? You can go on, and for instance, let's call again this a distribution, so you can measure the skewness or kurtosis of this distribution, which are the higher order moments. And it turns out that the same thing was done with other methods, like for instance gradients or speckles, and. So my sort of claim is that in fact a speckle beam is many focused spots. So if you got one focus spot, and here is an analogy with detection. Right? This is the top is the pinhole camera. Right? Pinhole camera makes image of an object without lenses. Right? So you've got an object, you've got a screen, punch a hole through the screen, and I get an image on the other side. So this was used, for instance, long ago. Then when people started to use it to make images, like for instance gamma ray astronomy or so, and they figured out that a single pinhole is really very, very ineffective, it takes too long to make an image, so why not making many pinholes? So if you make many pinholes, you will see a whole lot of images, but they all will have the same thing. So if you are able to actually decode these things, you can actually reconstruct the object, and at the same time, you do it much faster than with a single pinhole. So in fact, as David would say, a speckle system is just a completely delocalized scanning system. So instead of one spot, you've got many spots. And I'd like, obviously, to conclude with probably, I don't know if any of you here knows about that, but this was this is exactly what I was talking about. So you can do speckle tracking and recover higher order distribution, higher the moments of the distribution that will be, in general, used to build a better picture of the scattering distribution from the sample. Okay, perfect, 20 minutes. Thank you very much. I'm happy to get any questions. Thank you.
As you saw the high power record as a presentation of David, so we hope to put it on the ESRF YouTube channel after some processing. Maybe just look, see, I don't know when our public convention will do it, it's not so much time pressure from our side. Yeah, so otherwise email me and I'll send you the link probably in 1 or 2 weeks. Yeah. The other thing is, are there still people who need the manuscript, a script? How many?